Today we're going to talk about financial health. Pastor Charles Omolo here, and we'll be a life coach. And today the question is, why Christianity yet poverty? You know, poverty is painful. You know, ever felt shortchanged by God? You pray and pray, and yet you don't get the financial wealth that you desire. The question is, what must we do, or what must I do as a Christian, you know, to be able to stabilize my status or financial needs to be covered? And so there are questions, very pertinent questions, that are key to ask ourselves. And some of these questions are things that I've struggled with over the years. You know, what is this principle of the path, the way to the top, you know, that they say is difficult and only a few find it? How does this apply with finances? Why is it that only a few, you know, have the financial stability and not everybody? Is it true that poverty is a curse? You know, that's what many Christians as well say. You know, like currently as it is, I know of families who are completely drained financially. You know, the sole breadwinner died, and then the hospital bills which were left were so huge. They sold everything to be able to cover up all these bills. And at the end of it, although they lived well, but they remained poor. You know, currently people have lost their jobs, businesses have been closed, and we have families who literally are struggling. Apart from that, you find that loved ones who you take care of and they end up dying, and they leave these huge hospital bills that becomes a burden to the families who are left behind. You know, with old age also comes more health complications. And with the more health complication also, financial responsibility comes in. And these are things to think about. How do I plan when I'm still young? How do I plan into the future? You know, as for the poor old adults, poverty at times results to even premature death. And that's a reality that is around us all the time. And so the question I've got to ask ourselves is, what can I do to be able to help help me to be financially stable? And today we will look at the biblical principles on prosperity that never go wrong when appropriately applied in life. And so in the good book of life, the book of Deuteronomy chapter 8, you know, listen to this, chapter 8 verse 18, this is what the good book says. But remember the Lord your God, for it is He who gives you the ability or power to produce or get wealth, and so confirm this covenant which He swore to your ancestors as it is today. And He says, remember your Lord. It is He who gives you the power, the ability to produce wealth. So according to the above text, God does not give wealth, but gives each one of us an ability to make and to grow wealth. That has got to be very clear. And there's a covenant that He sticks by, He remains true to, and that will not change, that truly ability will be given. So according to the parable, you know, the parable of the talents, one was given one was given two, another one was given five. The one with the two and five went, invested, and then reproduced, but the one with one did not. You know, and that parable tells a lot. And to talent given to each and every one of us has been given by God, and God said that is according to each person's ability, which is a God's gift as well. And so God gives you power, the ability to make, the ability to get wealth. In fact, God does not give wealth. And this is one of the misconceptions, one of the things that I want to clarify today, and I hope it will come home. And so God gives the power and enablement to make wealth. What is power? Is a question to ask. It is defined as the rate of doing work, the rate of action. So the reason why most people, especially many Christians, tend to be poor first is because they believe that God gives wealth, whereas God gives the enablement to get wealth and not wealth itself. I will repeat that again. The reason why most people, especially Christians, tend to be poor is first because they believe that God gives wealth, whereas God gives the enablement. to get wealth and not wealth itself. Secondly, the impatience, not willing to wait on God, hence shortcuts. Now, let me explain a few things. So when he gives you the power, he expects you to work with it. This means there is God's part and the part that man has to play. Now, according to the book of Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, it says, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. So your harvest in life is absolutely dependent on what you sow. When you do your part, this is very important. Your harvest in life, making of wealth, is absolutely dependent on what you sow. God has his part, but man has to play his part. And so to the lazy who cheats their way into wealth, they are considered as robbers, by the way. So their destiny eventually becomes a prison of hell. So in the book of 1 Kings chapter 2 verse 3, it says, observe what the Lord your God requires. Walk in obedience to him and keep his decrees and commands, his laws and regulations as written in the laws of Moses. Do this so that you may prosper in all you do, wherever you lay or whatever you lay your hand on, and wherever you go. Now, the point that we normally remain faithful to and we remember quickly is so that you will prosper, and we quickly neglect the first part. It says that you and I must walk in obedience to the laws that God has laid down, and as well keep his decrees and keep his regulations. So these regulations, what are they? Is what we want to look at as we continue. And it says the laws of Moses. But as you do that, then what does it say? That he will truly prosper you. What does this mean? So in the law, men were to work. If you go back to the Old Testament, men were literally to work for 6 days, and then the rest was only for 1 day. Then the other myth that you have in our culture, you know, that Christians are very big about, is claiming prosperity in prayer and fasting, because it belongs to me. Now there's a covenant that God puts here, this part which he says, if you do this, I will do my part. And so claiming, it takes you back to the time of manna, you know, when the Israelites were leaving Egypt, coming down to the land of Canaan. In a time came when manna rained from heaven, and this was promised specifically for that community. So as soon as they neared the land of Canaan, that particular manna completely, you know, ended. It no longer continued. And so at times we dream and pray and fast, hoping that manna would come back. Some people are trying to claim prosperity as a promise. Prosperity is not a promise. They seek it with desperation, as though it is a debt owed to them by God. Not prosperity cannot be claimed. It is not a prophecy you wait or promise that you claim from God. It is an agreement you enter into. You know, both parties must play their part. And that's what the Galatians say. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man only reaps what he sows. So application of this principle, you know, there's a principle of the path that is very clear. There are long-lasting, proven, standing principles that can neither be defied or broken. One of them is the principle of gravity. You cannot defy gravity. You defy gravity, you get broken down. And it's very important to also equally understand this principle when it comes to wealth. Equally, so the path of wealth is an action-related principle which has its predictable results at the end of it all. At the end of you doing your part, the result will come. So the result cannot be manipulated or changed. I will give you an example. You take a seed, you plant on the ground. Of course, God will give rain. That seed, you have to, you know, weed it, all that, and then eventually it grows into a big. You cannot manipulate that. If you manipulate, even genetically, it has to give time for it to take, and all the chemicals you put for it to take time, give time for it to grow. In the book of Matthew 6:33, it says something that's important for us to understand. Seek his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. And so then again in the book of 2 Kings 2:3 says, observe what the Lord your God requires. Walk in obedience to his path. What are these two books saying? Seek first his kingdom, meaning there are principles of the kingdom that one need to understand and listen to. Those principles: a man who shall not work shall not eat. Do not associate with a lazy man. These are certain principles in the Bible. And literally, the work part of it is what many people avoid. But there's no production, no wealth will be made unless you understand clearly this principle of obedience to God's law. The 6 days of working and 1 day of resting. Having a clear understanding of the principle of prosperity, then only by particularly implementing do you prosper in life. Prosperity is a lifestyle, not a lottery or something or like get rich quick scheme. It doesn't happen. So when I do my part, God will do his part. He will always deliver. He never fails. The principle works both in the spiritual and physical realm. I hope up to there we're clear. And so this principle has been proven beyond doubt. And James speaks about it in James chapter 2, verse 17. That in the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by what I do. You understand? So you believe that there is one God. Good, even the demons believe and they shudder. You foolish people. He cannot say, you foolish people. Do you want evidence that faith without deed is useless? As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deed is dead. That's the book of James chapter 2. If you read verse 17 down to 26, talks about that. What is it saying? What is the application of this? That you and I, the law, the principle of the law remains, that you and I must do our part as God does his part. We can believe all we want, pray all we want, fast all we want, but we must be willing to go and put the energy at work and make things happen. So this law has been tested and proven. The formula of action in sowing, the righteous way, has predictable results. Structured action will take you to greatness. Remember this. Structured action, well-skilled, informed action will take you to greatness. There is no reason why you should be poor. Having understanding of this particular structure. So most people don't walk in prosperity because they don't know or obey this particular law. Allow, many times we allow worries to control us. And that's why you come back as you go through this. We pray, 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 nothing happens. We fast, nothing happens. And then we become worried. And there's one thing that you know, the book of Luke wrote in 12:25. It says, who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? None of us. But so the principle remains, and no worry, no amount of prayer and fasting will replace that principle, and that's very important. So pray about money. There are people who take their time and they pray about money. So I found out that most people pray, and their prayer is mostly about money. People mostly get deceived and feel should change when it comes to money. They pray, 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 and because they don't get it now, they start blaming God. I think the key principle for prayer should be pray for wisdom, for God to enable you to use your ability, to understand your ability, so that you can be able to work with ability and make money. That's a very valid prayer. And so, but as we do this, it's important to find balance. Because at times life can be so big about money. But the question that Mark himself in chapter 8, 36 says, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet forfeit or lose his soul? These are things worth thinking about. As I fight to look for money, as I work hard, it is always important to find balance. It is not just about money, but both spirituality and physical prosperity is what we need to pray about. But as we do this, we also must understand that there are vehicles that will drive you from one destination to another. And so the vehicle of delivery, it is not enough to know the right thing, but the delivery is equally important. In Ecclesiastes 10:15, it comes and says, the labor of a fool worries every one of them, because he is so ignorant of the ordinary matters that he does not even know how to get to town. What is he saying? The fool will labor. They will work so hard. But the labor does not bring the wealth or the desired destination. And so as we do what we do, we also must be careful to seek to understand, what vehicle am I using? What is my ability? And that ability, am I applying it correctly? And when I apply it, how and when should I apply this ability? So it is so foolish to be naive to think that just everything we do will bring wealth and prosperity. You don't understand the market, the wind, the flow. How does the market go about as you get involved? Of course, as you pray. And that's why, to the advantage that we have as Christians, seeking for advice is very key. It will help you understand things better, how to make things happen. So the way, the path requires skilled studying and understanding, or else your labor is in vain, is what that says. Now, the other thing is about sharpening our skills. You know, I used to really have a lot of struggles before. And a time came, I'm a minister, I'm a pastor, and I teach people, I help people. But a time came when I would struggle to even preach, because I did not have what to preach. So I found myself repeating what I did last month, going through this studies. But then fear would creep in. You're standing before people, you're shaking because... But I said, no, enough is enough. I started to seek for advice. What do I do? A brother came and told me, I think, Charles, you have the zeal, but you need to go to study. And so what happened, while I didn't go to school, I chose to start reading books. And I would read a lot of books. After reading books, my coordination started coming up slowly. And eventually, with the time I went back to school, last year I went to school, I did life coaching. I've done a bit of mental health and all that. And so they've helped. So sharpening your skills are very important as a Christian. Don't take that for granted. And I will help you. The book of Ecclesiastes 10, verse 10 says this. If the axe is dull and its edge unsharpened, more strength is needed, but skill will bring success. The other one in Proverbs 22 verse 29 says, do you see someone skilled in their work? They will serve before kings. They will not serve before officials of low rank. What am I trying to say? God, these are some of the principles. Says, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. Seek, understand the laws of God. God says we got to grow, sharpen our skills. You know, don't just think it will just happen because you and I pray. So many times we do things the same way, expecting, hoping and expecting to get different results. That will not happen. So a lazy man has no future, neither in the kingdom of God nor on the table of the wise. I will repeat. A lazy man has no future, neither in the kingdom of God nor on the table of the wise. Learning to use your ability appropriately is key. Without this, you and I limit God in his performance in our life, in your life by extension. And so to Moses, listen to what it tells him. Moses, he asked, what is that in your hand? He asked Moses. God works with what you and I have. And so when God looks at your hand, he sees unlimited, he sees much unlimited potential for blessing you, for showing miracle and bringing prosperity. And so the question we've got to ask ourselves is, what do you have that God can work with? Jesus Christ has about 5,000 to feed. But the question, he would have prayed for man and fish to come from heaven. But listen, he comes and asks the disciples, how many fish do you have? How many loaves of bread do you have? Bring them, that water will multiply. So sharpening your skills gives you an opportunity. The parable of the 10 virgins, 5 wise, 5 foolish, God will always work with what you have. And that is very key. Now, where you are, once you understand your ability, your potential, then you work hard to sharpen your ability. Are we together? And so at times this becomes a bit challenging and difficult. It's just good to be humble. This is where life coaches like us come in, to be able to understand you and help you out to come out of it. And it will not be much. So you come over to us, we will help you. Look for a life coach around you. Look for a counselor around you. They will help you to find yourself. With a lot of prayer and patience is very key. You know, the other thing again, is why is it that Christians seem to do badly off compared to non-Christians? What brings all this? You know, as I was reading the parable of the shrewd manager, the son that came up. In Luke 16 verse 8, so the master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. Then listen to what Jesus says. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than are people of the light. That caught my attention. What do you mean? That those of the world of darkness are more shrewd than those of the light? Jesus Christ was speaking something. What does it mean to be shrewd? To be shrewd is simply showing a sharp power, skilled, or being sober in judgment. That's what they say. And so why are people of the world considered shrewd than those of the light? What then must we do? These are questions worth answering and seeking. And so was Jesus Christ prompting Christians to shortcuts and evil patterns? I don't think so. Jesus is giving us an example of how people in the world look out for themselves in a way that God's people often neglect. That's what he's saying. I will repeat again. Jesus is giving us an example of how people in the world look out for themselves in a way that God's people often neglect. God desires that his children become shrewd, to have something to work with, to be sharp, to be sober, to be skilled, and make use of that skill, and he blesses that. As we continue, remember according to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 18, you know, God gives you power, ability to make wealth. And so he doesn't give you wealth directly. When you put your God-given talent and ability to use, it will produce for you and multiply your success rate. Very important. But steps that you must take, first of all, is understanding your ability. And like I say, that's where life coaching comes in. Your coach, to be able to be helped, and a counselor, or maybe a discipler, a Christian, fellow Christian will help you to understand, seeking for a lot of advice. Number two, the action. It doesn't matter how talented you are, you have to put all that you know into action. You must plant, you must sow, but according to your ability, not just randomly. And so get involved in tangible things that will yield enough tangible results for you to enjoy. Who enjoys? It is you who enjoys at the end of hard work. And so these principles as well is explained, you know, the wise man explains about this principle. In the book of Proverbs chapter 6, verses 6 to 11, it says, go to the ants, you sluggard. Why you sluggard? Consider its ways and be wise. It has no commander, no overseer, no ruler, yet it stores its provision in summer and gathers its food at harvest. How long will you lie there, you sluggard? When will you get up from your sleep? That's a question. When will you get up from your sleep? A little slumber, a little sleep, a little folding of the hand to rest, and poverty will come on you like a thief and scarcity like a bandit. Is that not how at times we feel, even though we pray and fast? You know, poverty will come to you like a thief and scarcity like what? Like an armed man, a bandit, you know? So we must be intentional to bring change into our life. Think out of the box is very important. You know, look, for those of us who work hard and yet you seem just to continue working hard and nothing happens, try, figure out, seek for advice, you know, life coaching or counselors or discipler, Christian, pastor, whoever it is. Try to think out of the box. It takes a lot of humility. I want you to remember, the tea farmers in my country, what they did is they realized that there were middlemen who were making a lot of money out of them. So what they did is they formed a circle and found good prices for their tea. Same happened with the coffee farmers. And what happened? They made an effort and removed the middleman. So that the money that the middleman chooses, you got to think out of the box. If you're stuck somewhere for a long time, it's always good to ask yourself why. You know, poverty is very painful, but poverty as well at times is a mindset. Because there are people who have it all. You have everything, but you still feel poor. I know of a story told about a man in prison. He was in jail. He was very rich, even came out, but still felt poor. Because in his mindset, he grew up in a poor environment. So regardless of how much he worked for and gained, he was still feeling poor. So you want to understand that poverty as well is a mindset. And so if you have that problem, that's where you seek for help and you'll be helped. So the Bible says, as a man thinketh, so he is. According to your faith will it be done. So at times you can have, but you still feel you're poor. It's good to be able to examine, what is my self? What? Why am I calling myself poor? Is it by comparison? Now there's a big part that I want to bring for us right now as we finish. There's freedom in Christ. Christ says, "For it is for freedom that Christ has set us free." So how do we find our freedom? I want you to go back. In the Old Testament, there were people who were poor once in a while, financial and all that. And so in the law, they put that when one would be taken in as a slave, a time would come after a period of time where they would be released to go. And if you took a poor man's land, after 7 years, at a year of Jubilee, you'd give the land back. But now in the New Testament, it comes in. Christ becomes our Jubilee. He becomes the redemption that when we are in Christ, we are set free. Free to what? In the book of Luke, listen, Luke 4:18 says, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free." Freedom is what he's talking about. Freedom from what? In Christ, literally, we're supposed to live a different life. For that, I will not go into detail today, but if you get some time, please feel free to contact me. I might be able to explain more. And so Jesus Christ walked the walk via Dolorosa to go to Golgotha, to go to Calvary, and then all that, the cross. He poured out his blood at the cross to be able to bring the freedom that we have. And that's why, when you go down, then do we really feel free as Christians? Spiritual freedom, you know, financial freedom. And these are things worth asking ourselves. And so quickly, you know, Paul speaks about it, you know, but God chose the foolish things of this world to shame all the wise. What is Paul saying? The Christians, we're supposed to shine. You understand? And so in all this, as we continue in finishing, there's so much to share, but let me leave it there. So we have a part, and as we do our part, God has his part. We also have to be very humble. Our part simply is to be able to walk, identify ability, but also the book of Proverbs 3:5-6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your path straight." And so as we do our part, we also must be willing. We must be intentional about leaning, depending on God, relying on him, praying for God to be able to make the works of our hands to prosper. Why? God loves you and I. And this is where prayer and fasting comes in to help us to rely on God, seeking for a lot of advice from friends as we continue. In finishing, simply, at New Life Health Opinion, we believe that doctors treat, but God heals. What we also do, we do medical tourism. And for medical tourism, this is a process of traveling outside the country